Good morning, everybody. We're a nice and cozy group here. We're gonna have you guys join us a little bit for the introit this morning, and we're gonna divide right down the middle here. People on this side are gonna follow people here, and the people on this side are gonna follow people here. You'll catch on, because we're gonna go through it one time to show you how it goes. So if you're on this side, fall to the side of the back. So it'll be different from most of us.
Something for getting here on this cold morning. So let's worship. Responsive reading in your bulletin. Please rise. We come to worship the Lord, about whom the angels rejoiced.
We worship the same Lord the shepherds found in Bethlehem.
We worship the Lord whom wise men found by following a star.
We worship the Lord over whom Simeon sang a song of thanksgiving.
We worship the Lord who called disciples to follow him.
We worship the Lord whose presence we find joy, peace, and renewal.
Our opening hymn is number 29.
Thank you.
7. Our Lord himself taught his disciples how to pray. In his teaching, he reminded them, and therefore us, of the importance of confession. For those acts of or failure to act which separate us from God, he invites us to seek forgiveness in order to restore our relationship with him. Let us pray together. Father, when our own preferences overshadow your will, forgive us. When we fail to speak out in the face of injustice, forgive us. When we see a need and yet turn away, forgive us. When we lack courage and yet do not seek your strength, forgive us. When our worship becomes mundane, renew us with the energy provided by your Spirit. Father, we seek to know you more dearly and to serve you more faithfully. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Prayer is one of God's sweetest gifts to us. As we pray our words and thoughts, they are carried to the throne of God as a fragrance pleasing to him. As we pray, the Holy Spirit takes our simple words and brings them as an offering to God. When we ask for forgiveness, God is ready to respond with love and compassion. God hears our prayers. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Also,
exchange the peace with each other. And now, I guess I should put my mask back on. And now I invite, I see two children back there. So I invite you to come forward and any adults who are brave enough to remember the child inside of you or to remember praying with your bodies, I invite you to come forward. Good morning. Tell me your names again. Allie? Allie and Addie. Thank you for coming forward. Oh, good. We have somebody else. So. You know, we talk about prayer a lot in church, and Pastor Doug, I should make an announcement. Pastor Doug is in quarantine with COVID. He's feeling fine, just fatigued, but he couldn't be here this morning, so I invited, well, he says I forced. Okay. I invited my husband, and Doug asked if we would preach and take care of the service this morning. I invited my husband, Dr. Daniel James Meter, to bring us the message this morning. So we're happy about that, right? So I was talking about prayer, and you know the Lord's Prayer, right? So I'm going to teach you. I need you to stand up. So we pray with our thoughts. We can talk to God in our thoughts. We can thank God and we can ask God to help us. And we pray with our mouths. We pray in church together. But sometimes it's nice to use our whole bodies for prayer. There are a lot of times in the Bible when people dance while they're praying. So a friend of ours who was an elder in our church in Brooklyn taught the children there this way to say the Lord's Prayer. So all you have to do is follow my motions, okay? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's do that one more. I think I forgot one motion. And people, stand up and join me. It's cold, and this will get our blood moving. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much. We'll practice that again sometime. You may go now to your classes. What is next? Hymn number 559. Let the congregation know of people who need our prayers.
Should I announce my class?
Yeah, I think you could.
Percy asked me if I would announce this. I'm leading an adult class here the last three Sundays in February. February something, something, and something. On the biblical roots of Reformed worship. So it's an adult class after the second service. And so Percy asked me to announce this today to get the word out. The biblical roots of Reformed worship, how Reformed church worship started, what its powers and principles are, but how we get those from the Bible. So the second Sunday in February will be the first one, and the last Sunday in February will be the third one. That's next month.
Thank you. Now it's time for our tithes and offerings. Mm-hmm. Father, these gifts and offerings represent our thanksgiving for who you are, what you have given to us, and how you want to work in the world. Use our offerings to bring the love of Christ to our community and through our church to the world you have called us to serve. Amen. You may be seated. Now, I am forever losing my pen, as Cheryl can attest. So this is a time when we can bring, thank you, my
help. It's my pen, it's not her pen.
My help meet. He always has a pen. So now is a time to bring our joys and concerns to the community. Of course, we will pray for Doug and his family. There's also Kendra Van Houten, who's a pastor at Fair Street Church in Kingston, also is COVID positive and will be quarantined. So this virus continues to invade us and affect us and change us. Joys and concerns? Yes? Oh, wow, that sounds, that's your brother,
and,
okay, and what's your name? Your name?
Jean.
Sorry, it's still so hard for me with people's masks on to know who's speaking to me. Okay. Well, I rejoice that you're here today. In spite of the obstacles, and join me in prayer.
We have a couple from online. I'm going to try to get them up here. You need pretty well.
Oh, okay.
Enjoy your
throwing you off there, am I? A couple of joys. Kevin and from this morning's service came in a little late. Was from Kevin and Sarah Phillips. They appreciate prayers for Kevin as he flies to Dakar. Sent to go tomorrow for a week of ministry at the Dakar Academy. And there was also another prayer from them this morning. They asked for prayers for Matthew Grogan, a first semester freshman at Yale. He was in a serious car accident last Sunday evening. He was in the hospital for 5 days. He's now home in Goshen for months of rehab. And
okay.
Do you want to write this down before I go to the next one?
I got it.
Okay. And there was asked for prayers for Joe and Carol Wilson and their son, Joe Jr.
Yes, Joe's son was recently diagnosed with cancer, and Joe was in and out of the hospital again this week, Joe Wilson. Let us pray. Let us pray for the church and for the whole world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, respond.
Hear
our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them to the joy of your salvation. We especially remember Lorene Friary suffering from COVID, Judy Phillips, Jerry Smith, Jenny Young, Betsy DeSoma, Don Garrison and his family after the death of his mother. Joe Wilson, Joe's son Joe, Nancy Newman, Doug Leonard. We pray for Kevin as he does a teaching assignment in Dubai. And we pray for Matthew, recovering from an accident. We pray for Jim, Jean's brother, to bring healing to him. Lord, there are so many names. We are interconnected in so many ways. And as we lift up these prayers, pray that you may comfort and encourage us as well. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we in the whole world may perceive the glory of his marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. And as our Savior Jesus taught us, we now pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I give you back your pen.
Thank you. My name is Daniel Meter. I'm retired from the Old First Reformed Church in Brooklyn, New York, where Abraham Paul Hamas's ancestor was a pastor. And I could look at some other windows too. Sarah Rapelia came from our congregation. I guess when they got some money, they moved up here. When I was in seminary, debating whether to be a minister, my first field education supervisor where I was seminary student helping out was Reverend David Hondorp at the Grace Reformed Church in Brooklyn. And he made a big impact on my life. Oh, I can take this off. David Hondorp, and he made a big impact on my life that I might consider being a pastor after all. The previous pastor at that church was Reverend Joel Holbrook. And my dad was pastor also in a church in Brooklyn. And Joe and my dad knew each other. So I've known Taylor my whole life. Since before I have no memory of the first time I ever knew him. He was a little kid, a little bit younger than me. And we've both grown up together in the Reformed Church, two alpha males trying to be friends. I would say, why don't you do it my way? And Taylor would say, why don't you do it my way? But we're friends now, so. And then Doug Leonard and I have known each other for a long time and done a lot of work together and a lot of things. And now I know him as my wife's boss. So anyway, it's a great pleasure to be here. And I worshiped here, as you might remember, last year when we were living in Poughkeepsie and looking for a congregation to be with. So I'm very honored to be here in this congregation. And I want to tell you why you have the scripture lessons you have this morning. I know that Pastor Doug was going to begin a series on prayer, but I did not want to preempt that. So I just took, as is my custom, the lessons from what's called the Common Lectionary, which is a calendar of scripture lessons used by a whole number of churches. And it just happened to be that for the second Sunday after the Epiphany, the gospel lesson this year is from John, and the epistle lesson is from 1 Corinthians, and that's the only reason these texts have been chosen, not because I think you need to hear those more than anything else. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of eternal life which you have given us in Christ Jesus our Lord. To whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray by idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, let Jesus be cursed, and no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. A reading from John. Very early in the Gospel of John, the beginning of the second chapter, after Jesus has gathered his first disciples from among the disciples of John the Baptist and gone from the Jordan back up to Galilee. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. And Jesus said to her, woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come. Melody used to say to me, Danny, you should not talk to your mother the way you do. It's not right. Sometimes the mystery of discussion between sons and mothers is beyond us. It's a little edge here, I think, and John means it to be a little bit, not humorous, but there's a little edge between Jesus and Mary here. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, fill the jars with water. And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, now draw some out and take it to the chief steward. So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now. Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I will talk about the epistle lesson, 1 Corinthians, at the end of the sermon, and I will use it for an application. 1 Corinthians was one of the earliest New Testament books to be written, while the Gospel of John was written much later. In fact, it's the last of the four Gospels to be written, and it assumes you already know the Gospel of Matthew. So the Gospel of John takes its own course. The fact that it was written much later does not make it any less close to Jesus. Yes, there's a distance, and you can sense the distance in the development of Christian doctrines that are by this time in the Gospel. But at the same time, it was written by Jesus' best friend, who had an insight into Jesus that not even Matthew, Mark, and Luke had, and was able to give words to Jesus that were deepest to Jesus' own mystery. So it's distant, but even closer than the other three. It's different than the other Gospels because it has no parables. And only seven miracles. And different miracles than in the other Gospels. And these miracles are not called miracles, but signs. And as at a sign is something that you look at that points to something else, so these signs in John, these miracles, are not just wonderful actions, but are even like parables in themselves. That's why there's no parables, because there are signs. You have to read these signs, these miracles, because they point to something. They're worth taking apart and understanding. In a parable in Matthew, which you have to unpack it, you unpack it by turning this way and that way and this way and that way. But in a sign of in John, it's more like you unpeel the layers. There's a layer that's true, but then there's a deeper layer that's even more true, and then a deeper layer that's even more true. And the more you know about the Old Testament, the more you can see the layers and understand what the layers are saying. So we're going to do that with this first of Jesus' signs in John. We're going to take away the layers. And we're going to start at the outermost, the most obvious. The Christian faith is like a wedding reception. Is that good or bad? I think that's good, right? Good? Yeah. And Jesus is the life of the party. In him was life, writes John in chapter 1. In John 14 says, I am the way, the truth, and the... Chapter 20, these things are written that you may have in Jesus' name. He is the living water in John chapter 4. In John 17, he is the vine in whom you must abide in order that you may bear fruit, without whom you cannot live. So combine vine, water, life, and you see what's in this story. Jesus is the life of the world, which is the kingdom, and he's the life of the party, which is the church. What's also obvious, right from the start, is the power that Jesus has. He has the power to command the laws of nature, to serve salvation. Now, it is natural, as C.S. Lewis points out somewhere, it is very natural for grapevines and yeast to turn water into wine. That's what grapevines and yeast do all the time. But Jesus reveals his power to command nature to do his own bidding at a different speed and for a different purpose. He makes nature come to new life in his name. That's power. So now we're going to go one layer in. What does wine do at a party? It makes it festive. people get loose. It's a sign that you're not in a rush, that you don't have to be somewhere at 2 o'clock. Wine is a sign of good times and good cheer, of prosperity, of leisure time. And in the Old Testament, it's a sign of joy. Psalm 104. So Jesus chooses wine to say, I've come because the nature of the life that I give you is not just water, the basic bare necessity of life, but something festive, joyful, wine that gladdens the heart. So life in his name is not just for survival, but for joy. And then consider how much wine it is. 6 stone jars full of water. 20 to 30 gallons each, so that's 25 gallons, say. So 6 gallons, 150 gallons. Convert that to wine, that's 600 bottles of wine. Convert that to glasses of wine, that is 3,000 glasses of Beaujolais Nouveau. How long will this party go on? The life of Jesus is abundant life. The normal life that we're used to, the longer it goes on, begins to thin out, begins to wear down, begins to age, begins to get less and less. But the life with Jesus, his abundant life, increases and expands as it goes on. Gets thicker and deeper. It's like the river in Ezekiel, that the longer it goes, the wider it gets, even in the desert. It is so vital that it overflows past death and spreads out into eternity. The abundant life of Christ. Then we get another layer in. The 6 stone jars are not just any jars. If you've been to an Orthodox Jewish wedding reception, you know that as you enter the hall, there's going to be all these vessels of pure water, no soap, just water, where you have to go through the ritual of purification before you... What am I doing? You all knew that, and you didn't say anything. Watch it, you're thinking, watch out for that mic! So you go to the wedding reception, there are all these... That's what happens when I start walking around. You go to the wedding reception, all these... And people are washing, and everyone has to do it. And whenever you have another meal, if it's kosher, you have to wash again. So depending on how long the wedding reception goes on, you go through a lot of water. So that's what's, and you have to repeat a special blessing. That's the ritual. That's what this water is for. The water of purification. So Jesus is making a sign here. He's taking the laws of Moses and the rituals of the Jews, of Judaism, and accelerating them, converting them, to go from cleansing to drinking, from the promise to the answer, from the hope to the arrival. The love of God in Moses, the fear of God in David, is made into the enjoyment of God with Jesus. This is an intimacy with God that's a little scary. So the steward says when he tastes the wine, it's been good wine all along, but you've saved the best for last. Just as God was always good to Israel, Psalm 73, all through the Old Testament, but now at the coming of the Lord Jesus, God has saved the best for last. As this water was for purification, and the wine is for satisfaction, just so as Israel kept doing its purification in order to be ready for the promised Messiah, so now the hope of Israel was satisfied. The Messiah was here at last. Your centuries of waiting are over. Your preparation is done. The Messiah has come. So it's time to rejoice, to go from washing to drinking, from cleaning to feasting, from discipline to dancing. As my sister-in-law said the other night to someone in the kitchen, will you please stop loading the dishwasher and come and have dessert? It's time. So these layers are easy to peel. But the story does keep some things hidden. Like, what all exactly was that with Jesus and his mother? And how much did his mother know, and when did she know it? And when exactly did the water turn into wine? While it was still in the jars, or while the servants were carrying it, or when the steward drank it? The story hides that from us. Only Jesus and the servants knew really what had happened. So the sign was hidden from most of the people. The steward is impressed and surprised, but not at Jesus. He doesn't know what's happened. He's surprised at the bridegroom. The strange behavior of this bridegroom who keeps the good wine till the end. And that's where the story leaves it. We're not even told how the disciples found out. Just so God's revelation answers questions you need to know, but not every question you want to know. God's revelation is full of surprises, often telling you what you would not have thought to have asked, and not telling you what you'd kind of like to know to make your life easier. The signs of God should always keep surprising us. There is hiddenness, but also clarity. And it has to do with what God thinks we need to know. The story ends by saying that this was the first of Jesus' signs by which he revealed his glory, which is a surprise when you think about it, because except for what the servants saw, he kept his glory hidden. The glory of Jesus was hidden in plain sight. He didn't show it off, and his glory was not yet here widely manifested. He revealed his glory only to those he wanted to at this point, though everybody got to enjoy it. Is that what he meant when he said to his mother, "My hour has not yet come"? He did not yet want to show himself completely, lest he be misunderstood, but only quietly and carefully and in stages, and only to those whom he needed to at this time to believe. And at this point, it's only to his disciples, and only partially with more to come. His full glory in John, if I may say so, is finally not what you would expect, but according to John, on the cross in his humiliation, which they were not yet ready to see. We push this one more layer in. At the beginning of the story, Jesus is a guest. By the end of the story, he is the host, because it's his wine they're all drinking. That means he's really the bridegroom. It's really now his reception. Only if you know this, but it's now his party. And if he's the bridegroom, if that's what the Lord Jesus is intending, then he's also intending Isaiah chapter 62. Where God is the bridegroom and Israel is the bride, called Beulah, called Hephzibah. So the wine is the sign that the Lord Jesus is no one else than the Lord God of whom Isaiah prophesied. The glory that he reveals, even if it's only to a few, his glory is the glory of God, full of grace and truth, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father. first chapter. Nobody but Jesus knows this yet, but at this wedding reception, one of the guests was not invited. And that guest was God. Can you imagine if God came to your party? Would you be afraid? Would you have as much fun? Might you stop drinking? This story has surprises, but the greatest surprise is that God was hiding in plain sight. The Almighty, the one holy God, the author of the universe. That is who is manifested at this party, this epiphany story, this manifestation story, in the flesh and blood of Jesus, whose spirit is the wine. God is the fountain, God is the source of life. I think the main point of this story is an invitation. No application in the traditional sense of learn how to do this, simply to believe. Because John says, if you believe these things, you will have life in his name. So this story is simply an invitation to believe again, this week, to believe again, or to believe for the first time. And I invite you to believe this story because there's life in it for you. And I suppose an application that I could make for my own sermon is simply to cause you to wonder, to praise. Nothing else than that. Simply to enjoy this story for the sake of the glory of God, just so that you can be richer and deeper as a human being. And thanks to the story, simply to glorify God and enjoy God forever, which is what a human being is supposed to do. But since this is a Reformed church, you want a practical application, right? So I'm going to give you one. And I'm going to use this story in combination with our epistle lesson from 1 Corinthians. And that has to do with spiritual gifts, with what we expect from spiritual gifts in the church. And here's the lesson. Just as it's water that gets turned to wine, so your natural gifts are converted into spiritual gifts by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not that the Lord Jesus makes wine poof out of nothing in the air like magic. The Lord Jesus takes the natural process of water turning into wine and makes that natural process supernatural by God's investment. It's true of so many of the Lord Jesus' miracles, turning one thing into something else. In the Bible, there's no division between natural and supernatural, as if creation were natural and miracles were supernatural. That is a modern secular division that is not in the Bible. Nature itself is supernatural in that it is the field of God's love and activity. And God, for whatever God has purposes, salvation accelerates nature or spins it or enhances it or heals it. The wine that Jesus made from the water was ideal wine, but it was still real wine. In the same way, when the Holy Spirit gives you spiritual gifts, these are not some magical gifts from out of the air. These are your natural gifts and talents which the Holy Spirit converts, accelerates, enhances, and heals. This is why when we elect a new deacon, as you have done, you look for the gifts in that person that have to be connected with the personality of that person. Just as the resurrected body of our Lord Jesus in the same body that was crucified is the same body that was crucified, and his glorious body is the same body that was humiliated, so too your spiritual gifts are the same as your natural gifts, only now converted through repentance of your selfishness in using them, repentance of your indolence in not using them, repentance of however you used them in the past, repentance and then offering them as a sacrifice of thanksgiving for the use of God, quickened by the power of the resurrection. What I'm telling you is different from the magical thinking that some churches teach, but it is, I believe, more biblical and therefore even more wonderful and miraculous in that for the sake of the new creation, God does not abandon the old creation, but cleans it and heals it and makes new life from the dead. And it's wonderful in that it shows us how God loves the world, even the old and corrupt and dying world, which God does not abandon, but saves. Not to discard it, but to redeem it and raise it up. So that means that God's activity is always a loving activity. Spiritual gifts, miracles, supernatural use of nature. It's always loving. So if you push the deepest layer of the gospel story, what you see here in this story of a wedding is love, because, of course, it's a wedding reception, which is the celebration of love, of committed love, of joyful affection, and of holy desire. That is the reason God gives you abundant life, because of God's desire for you, God's affection for you, God's love for you. God commits to you. God says, I am yours and you are mine to have and to hold from this day forth forever, for richer, for poorer, for better or for worse, and death will never us part. This is how much God loves you. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and has made us kings and priests to God and his Father, unto him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord's countenance be lifted upon you and give you peace. Amen.